sosyal psikoloji ve psikanalizle harmanlıyor. Bu dört anabilimi bir araya getiriyor. Yıllardır tüketicilerin bilinç dışı yaptıkları seçimler bunun üzerine hem araştırma yapıyor, hem bilgi üretiyor, hem de yöntem geliştiriyor. Ben keşke evlenmeden önce tanısaydım. Bilinç dışı seçim. Çok saçma yani, evliyim. Değil mi? Şahane bir şey, 10 yıldır evliyim. Bir tane de oğlum var. İnteraktif olduğunu söyleyeceğim, sorun yok. Karşılıklı o anlayacağız. Sen diyeceksin, sen anlayacaksın, o demeyecek. Bunu başarabiliyorsunuz. Lifetime marriage harika bir şey. Efendim kendisi bugüne kadar dünyanın çok değerli markalarına hizmet verdi. General Electric, Procter & Gamble, Boeing, L'Oreal gibi birçok dev şirkete danışmanlık yaptı. İnsanlar niye belli ürün ve hizmetleri ve markaları belli zamanlarda tercih ediyorlar? Niye? Niye? Bu çok temel soruyla ilgili siz perdesini bizim için aralamaya çalışacak. Yapım ve içerik başlıklı sunumuyla hanımefendiler ve beyefendiler Dr. Protem Rafael veriyor.
In our brain. And without being aware of it, we keep reactivating these structures. And I will give you several examples of that. Starbucks doesn't sell coffee. Big mistake. Lamborghini doesn't sell cars. Big mistake. I mean, if you want to buy a Lamborghini, go to the internet and you find these cars that are 2 or 3 years old and they have 150 kilometers, which means that nobody drove them. So you don't really buy this car to drive them. Like right now in Singapore, if you buy a very expensive apartment, you have an elevator to take your Lamborghini to your apartment, and there is a window, and you can park your car for all your guests to watch the car. These cars are made to be put on a shelf, not to drive them. So when you realize that what people say, oh, I bought this car because it's a very good, I like to drive it, it's very fast. Why did you buy a Lamborghini in Switzerland where most of the time there is speed limit at 25 kilometers per hour? You know, what is the idea? So I don't believe what people say. Let me give you an example. One of my clients is Boeing. You know, they make airplanes. And I work on the Dreamliner, the 787, with them. And before deciding to build the Dreamliner, because they were competing with Airbus and the Europeans, they said, we're going to run regular kind of marketing. We're going to ask people, what do they want in an airplane? And I'm sure all of you are traveling all the time, taking airplanes, so they will ask you, what do you want in an airplane? All right. So people will say, well, you know, I want legroom, I want space, I want good food, I want good service, I want good entertainment. So they should do it, you know. And then Airbus, they build this humongous airplane where you're going to die with 800 people, right? But on the other side, you say, I don't believe what people say. So what we need is that we go back to the very first imprint you have in your life of something like that, you know, traveling. And what we discover is that when all of you here, when you have money, when we have money, what do? We take a private jet where there is no legroom, no food, no service, and no entertainment. Wow. So what is it that people really want? This is what they say, but this is what they really want. What we really want is very simple, is no airport. Why? Because the airport has been designed by mentally retarded engineers. This is the worst place, I mean, this is terrible, right? So we don't want to. So, by the way, I've done this work, like 10 years ago, and I spoke with several airlines, and already right now, if you have a chance to fly Air France or Lufthansa first class, they take you from the lounge to the plane in a car. You don't go to the airport. I remember the first time I was offered this service at Lufthansa. I was in the lounge and they say, do you want a Porsche or a Mercedes? I said, wow, interesting. Porsche, all right. So we went to the Porsche and a driver with a Porsche brought me to the plane. It was just, so no airport. So they already offer that kind of service, right? So this is what is key here. We cannot believe what people say because sometimes, you know, we're busy in a little theater that is mainly done by what everybody says. Everybody says we want bigger, we want legroom and so on. But when the reality it is very different. So I believe in the structure. I believe in the structure. If you remember West Side Story, very nice. New York, the gangs, the cars, everything. Okay. But this is the same structure as Romeo and Juliet. Oh. Now, Romeo and Juliet, we are in another century in Italy, and they have no cars, no New York, no. So the whole content is different. But this is the same structure. And that is the melody. The structure is what is the melody. Maybe some of you are familiar with Cyrano de Bergerac. You know Cyrano de Bergerac, a big nose, he was fighting with a sword. They made a movie called Roxanne, where Steve Martin fights with a tennis racket. So sword, tennis racket, doesn't matter. You can tell the story with different content. But you have to respect the structure. Cyrano de Bergerac, what is the structure, right? Well, it is ugly and intelligent. Ah. This connection cannot be changed. If he was intelligent and handsome, there is no story. The other guy is handsome and dumb. Again, if the other guy was handsome and intelligent, there is no story. They both in love with the same woman. That's a French story. So, and again, you cannot change that. You see, so there are things that element of the structure that you cannot change. If you change this element of the structure, then there is no communication there. If you factor with music, when you want to play a melody, right, you can play with your left hand on the piano, move and play on the right hand on the piano, different notes. But if you respect the structure, same melody. You can play with the violin, the cello, different time of the day, different age. I mean, all that is irrelevant. What you have to respect is the space in between. The space in between. So the first thing I would like to tell you today is watch the space in between. That's where the deep meaning is. My professor, Lévi-Strauss, I studied with him in Paris, used to say that the mother, is not a woman. Oh, maybe some of you thought that you were a woman, right? No, a mother is not a woman. Ah, a mother is a space between a woman and a child. Oh, no children, no mother. No mother, no children. The space in between. Watch the space in between all the time. That's where the structure is. That's where the message is. Very, very powerful, very important. So the music is a space in between. That's why you can transpose the melody from one instrument to another and so on. But you have to respect the structure. When you want to communicate a message, you have to look at the space in between. And be careful that you communicate this space in between. Right? And so some of the first imprints we have in our life are really elements of structure that is transmitted by the culture. And so without being aware of it, usually, when you have a mother, a Turkish mother and a Turkish father, you usually have a Turkish child, right? I mean, it's very rare that you get a Brazilian or a Chinese or Japanese, very rare, huh? So there is a way to transmit the culture. We know that when a man and a woman have a child, they usually have a little human being. Huh? It's very rare that you get a bird, a fish, a cat. So that's a code, that's a genetic code. But my theory is that there is a code for each culture. And without being aware of it, we transmit this code through one generation to another, through advertising, the art, the movies, the novellas, all that we transmit this code. So I want to give you an example, because sometimes people ask me, what do you do? It's a very difficult question, by the way, but I say, I think I psychoanalyze cultures. I try to understand the collective unconscious. It's unconscious, so you cannot ask people, tell me what is your unconscious, because you're not aware of it, otherwise you would be conscious. So, I was born in France by accident or chance, so I don't know why I didn't choose to be French, but I was just born there. But I chose to become an American, so now I'm an American, that's my choice. But my first imprint were very French. And I really enjoy psychoanalyzing the French all the time. It's so interesting. So one of the things that is very obvious, and maybe you're aware of that, that there is a very strong collective unconscious. The French don't want to work. Work is bad. Who want to work? So what is the ideal situation? Never to work. Now, where that come from? Well, it comes from, maybe some of you read Stand Out, the rouge et le noir, the black and the red. That's a very famous novel that we all learned in school in France. Le rouge et le noir, the red and the black, means that's your destiny. My parents told me, your life, you should choose between the red and the black. So black, you should become a priest. I said, red, you should become a soldier, like your father. So I didn't want any of these, but there is no other choice, really. Right? So make money, I will vulgar get that. To try to sell something, I will vulgar get that. Only the merchants are. But so the reference system in the collective unconscious is the aristocrat. The aristocrat doesn't work, but he gives his life to the king or he gives his life to God. Fine. Today, the French are absolutely exactly the same. But the content is different. Who are the new aristocrats? The communists, the socialists. They just don't want to work. Give me everything for free, and I don't want to work. So the same behavior, the same structure, is now used by another generation with exactly the same attitude. I mean, it was amazing to see the students in having a big demonstration in the street. And they had signs that say, we don't want anything to change. Oh. No change. Oh. The French are very conservative. They don't want anything to change, which means including, I don't want to work. Sarkozy made a complete mistake. He didn't understand the structure. He said, work more to make more money. Work more? I mean, this is why should I work more? I mean, this is no way. That's why it's illegal in France still today to work more than 35 hours a week. Illegal to work. Now they have a big demonstration because some crazy people want to work on Sunday. Wow. This is immoral. This is bad. You should not want to work. You see,